Without the visual help of George Catlin's and Seth Eastman's depictions and portraits of Native American life in the 19th century, there would be difficulty studying and remembering American Indians. George Catlin is thought of as one of the greatest American painters to record Native Americans' plains life before it vanished. Seth Eastman and his wife Mary Henderson Eastman focused on recording and understanding the way of the Sioux peoples near and around Fort Snelling. Without the contribution of these three people, some tribes would have not been visually recorded. The art that these men created is important for the simple idea that there are very few people who actually depicted the Native American peoples as human beings. Life in the 19th century as a Native American was difficult. With Jeffersonian administration obligating the white people of the United States to gain more territory, the Native Americans are forced farther westward.
George Catlin saw the Native Americans as a dying race. Thus, he felt responsible for recording their history and making sure that they were remembered. Born in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, Catlin spent most of his childhood outdoors, fishing, hunting, and looking for Native American artifacts. Catlin's love of the Native people kindled from his mother's own curiosity. As a young girl, Catlin's mother was kidnapped and held captive for quite some time. This, along with a natural curiosity, moved Catlin out of his early career as a lawyer and into a career he was much more passionate about, painting. His earliest known works were paintings and sketches of nature sites along the Erie Canal. By 1829, Catlin had caught the fever of cultural nationalism. In his opinion, it was his responsibility to preserve the dying breed that was disappearing fast. Determined to paint the dying race and its environment, he moved to St. Louis in 1830. There he met and became friends with General William Clark, a well-known explorer of the time. At the time, Clark was the superintendent of Indian affairs and allowed Catlin to paint the many Indian leaders and delegates that he met with. Clark asked Catlin to accompany and illustrate his journey up the Mississippi. Shortly after, Catlin traveled with Clark to Piriachuin on the upper Mississippi River. There, Catlin encountered and painted portraits of many tribes, including Kickapaws, Ashanis, Omahas, Anishinaabe, Pawnees, Sioux, Blackfoot, Mandan. Few portraits of the Mandan people exist as they soon disappeared due to the smallpox epidemic. Catlin was one of the only people to visually capture these people. From 1830 to 1836, St. Louis was the base point of his travels. Catlin made 5 trips up the Mississippi River, creating over 500 paintings, visiting 47 tribes, while collecting many artifacts. Paintings made for these travels were later known as Catlin's Indian Gallery, including the artifacts that he collected. Finding a suitable and sustainable home for his art was a difficult process. Proposed to the government to buy his paintings, unfortunately they denied him. Turning east in 1838, Catlin decided to take his gallery on a tour, traveling to big cities such as Pittsburgh, Cincinnati, and New York. On this tour, Catlin was criticized for portraying the native in such a calm way. When he heard the term savages used to describe Indians, he denounced the word. He praised the Indians as honest, hospitable, and faithful. In 1839, he traveled to Europe to show the world his paintings, visiting London, Paris, and Brussels. A French critic once stated that Catlin has brought back alive the proud and free characters of these chiefs, both their nobility and manliness. Catlin wished to sell his gallery as to pursue the history of these people intact. Again, he proposed that the United States government buy and save his collection. They denied this proposal. In his eyes, he was a Native American's historian. He felt responsible for visually depicting this dying breed. His job, as he saw it, was to simply record their last moments. Financially unstable, Catlin was forced to sell his entire works. In 1852, Joseph Harris bought all 607 paintings. After this, Catlin decided to recreate his entire collection, later known as the Cartoon Collection, as it was recreated from the templates of the previous works. Currently, Catlin's Indian Gallery resides almost completely intact at the Smithsonian. Including both artifacts and paintings, the Smithsonian considered it to be one of the crown jewels because of the almost complete collection. Despite relative accuracy, Catlin's understanding of his subject was heavily influenced by the biases of his time.
After graduating from West Point Military Academy in 1929, 21-year-old Seth Eastman entered the military as a second lieutenant in the 1st Infantry Regiment, making his career in the Army as a map maker and recording the activities of the Army. He also learned the Sioux language. After being reassigned to West Point in 1833, Eastman taught drawing and map making for 7 years. Being assigned as a commander at Fort Snelling in 1841, he moved there with his new wife, Mary Henderson Eastman. Both had an interest in the Dakota people that lived near and around Fort Snelling. Mary Henderson Eastman, born in the elite painting family, moved to West Point because her father was a top surgeon. Mary used her time at Fort Snelling to write a book which her husband illustrated for her. A book called The Dakota or Life of Legends of the Sioux Around the Fort Snelling was published in 1849. Mary also wrote a 19th century bestseller, which was actually a pro-slavery novel and defended the Southern Slaveholding Society. In 1847, Eastman won a congressional commission to illustrate information regarding the history, condition, and prospect of the Indian tribes. Written by Henry Rowe, this is a 6-volume set of novels that had information on many tribes and their differences, as well as similarities. George Catlin was also up for the nomination, but Eastman evidently won. This set, published from 1851 through 1857, included 275 exquisite illustrations. Combining detailed and accurate sense of documentation with a subject that he had a unique exposure to, Eastman lacked a sense of drama in his paintings. Although his paintings offered a simple glance at the Native American life, not shown by other artists, his career as a painter is divided into two sections. 1829 to 1849, most of his works are simple, and this is when his works start to mature. 1850 to 1875 were the productions of artist merit, but dependable records of the scenery and native life of the frontier West. Some have been bold enough to say that Eastman was a superior to Catlin, since he was a military man with more training. Eastman went on to serve in the Civil War as a quartermaster general. He retired as a brigadier general. The United States House of Representatives Committee on Military Affairs also commissioned him to paint images of 17 important military forts. These paintings were conducted from 1870 to 1875. Eastman died in Washington in 1875. Most of his works remain intact, held at the Smithsonian, Minneapolis Institute of Arts, and the Minnesota Historical Society.
George Catlin is not considered a great artist in a technical sense, but in his gallery he achieved something nobody else of the time had. He sketched and painted pictures of Native Americans and their way of life, just before the inroads of the white settlers began to destroy their society. Seth Eastman is iconic to Minnesota history because the natives that he had spent so much time with were the natives at Fort Snelling. He felt they had the right to be remembered.